USA Warrior Stories is a not-for-profit organization designed to record, archive, and share videos of veteran stories to help veterans make a connection with one another and to help us all better understand their sacrifices for our freedoms.
My father was in World War I. He served in the Army. I guess I was born in 21, so that was around the start of the Roaring Twenties. But then you had the Great Depression. So all my school years were pretty much during the Depression. It was tough, but you know, you got along. We had food on the table. And yeah, you know, funny thing, I can still remember the lineups from the first Yankee game I saw back in 1936. You had Bill Dickey catching, Hall of Fame, Lou Gehrig on first, Hall of Fame, Tony Lazzari at second, Hall of Fame, Frank Presetti at short, I don't remember whether he made the fame or not, Red Rolfe at third, Myro Hoag in left, Joe DiMaggio in center, he was a rookie that year, and Twinkle Toes Selkirk in right. The pitcher was Red Ruffing in the first game and Lefty Gomez in the second game. They were playing against Boston. Then as soon as the Depression was getting over, the war started. Actually making products for Britain and Russia in the late 30s and early 40s, that's, I think, what got us out of the Depression. Yeah, I was drafted when they started taking them under 21. When I got inducted, I went to Fort Dix. A couple of days later, they sent me to Atlantic City for basic training. I didn't quite finish the basic when they sent me to Seymour Johnson Field down in North Carolina for airplane mechanic school. And the school down there ran 24/7. There were four shifts, 6 hours, and you rotated, so you hit all of them during your time there. In addition to the going to school 6 hours a day, you had at least an hour of calisthenics, another one for close order drill. You had chemical warfare stuff and anopheles, mosquitoes for malaria, and gas chamber. You had to go through a gas chamber, you know, to identify the various gases and stuff like that. But you were busy. You had one day a week off. Like I said, you went to school 6 hours a day. You had four shifts. And it so happened that our barracks was on the 6 to 12 at night. And the whole barracks didn't have the same day off because they kept starting classes every day. So there was only two of us in the barracks that were off. It was me and this other fella. And we went into town, Goldsboro, and there wasn't much there. And we went to the hotel. They had a bar there, but North Carolina was a dry state. But they did have 3-2 beer. And you drink enough of that, you can. So we were there, had a good time. So we come back, and it's probably 9 o'clock at night. And this other guy starts getting rambunctious. He starts tearing all the bunks apart. And I started laughing so hard I couldn't stop him. So he finally gets some more. Tore them every bed except his and mine. I figured, boy, he went to sleep. I said, I got to stay awake because I got to watch it when these guys come and they don't kill him. Fortunately, they all took it good naturedly, but they could have killed him. But after I finished school, I was sent to Larnberg Maxton Army Air Base in North Carolina. And this was a base where they were training glider pilots. So it turned out while I was there, I never got to work on an airplane, but I probably worked on thousands of gliders. Yeah, we knew they were cargo carriers, also airborne infantry. They carried like 14 troops, but we know you could put a Jeep and a howitzer in there, and they were quite big. I would say the wingspan was maybe 85 feet, and that would probably be within 5 feet either way of what it actually was. Well, they used them when they invaded a lot of places. They just landed them, and they were supposed to get out and fight. You know, it was when the pilots are training, you know, they're landing on a field, that's fine. But after that, you're not going to land on a field when you're over where the war's going on. So they had them landing all over the countryside down there. And this is why so many of them were damaged, because they were landing in cornfields and everything else. They get used to what they have to do. And we'd send crews out, and they would dismantle them, put them on 40-foot trailers, bring them back, lay them on the ground, and we had to put them back together again and make repairs and whatever was necessary. As I said, I went to airplane mechanic school, and I was classified as an airplane mechanic. They were much more complicated than the gliders. So I always wanted to get out of there after a while. And one day the engineering officer said to me, he says, "Why don't you change your MOS? I says, "Why?" He wanted me to change it to a glider mechanic, which is a lower classification. I says, "No, I don't think so. I think I can get out of here quicker as a mechanic." So not long after that, there was a notice on a bulletin board. They were looking for glider mechanics to volunteer for overseas. So as soon as I heard that, I hit at the base headquarters and got my MOS changed. When I got down near the end, I was making out the will. Some sergeant comes in, he comes up to me. He says, "Are you Sergeant Solvik?" I said, "Yes." He says, "You're not going anywhere." I guess he thought he's going to make me happy because he got me pulled off. And I actually told them off. You wouldn't usually do that. So it seems that not long after that, I got home on furlough because I wanted to see my brother. He was coming back from the Aleutians. When I come back, it was like the train station where I had to get off was in Hamlet, North Carolina, which was like 30 miles from our base. And it's like 3 o'clock in the morning. So I come in my barracks. Well, I don't want to wake anybody up. I don't put the light on. I go sit on my bed. All I feel is springs. So I laid down, went to sleep with my clothes on. I wake up in the morning. I look around. There's nothing in the barracks, but all the beds were stripped. No foot lockers, no clothes. All my stuff was gone. So I go to the orderly room. They found they shipped out half the guys, and I was moved to another barracks in that. And it wasn't long after that they sent me to Greensboro, North Carolina. That was a staging area. And then from there, we were there like a week or two. We went up to Kilmer, Camp Kilmer. And that was, again, a staging area. And next thing you know, we were on a train to Hoboken at night, and we loaded real late at night, and it was on the Queen Elizabeth. And we were the last ones to load, so we got the best quarters down at the bottom of the ship in what they called the garage deck. And they had hammocks about three high, and there's about 400 of us down there, so the air wasn't too good. It was like 22,000 troops on the Queen Elizabeth, incidentally. So that was a prize for the submarines. And one night we hear boom, boom, boom. And some of the guys started getting a little panicky trying to get up on deck. But where we were, you had to climb a ladder to get out. That's how deep we were. And somebody talked to the English crew, you know, about that. They said they were practicing. Well, the next day, we pulled into Greenock, Scotland. And the Queen Elizabeth is too big, I guess, to berth in the port itself. So we had to get off onto a lighter. And they had the radio on, they had a loudspeaker. The BBC was on. And they come with an announcement that the German high command announced that they had sunk the Queen Elizabeth with 22,000. But here we are getting off the boat. So I, and there we were on a train. I ended up in a place called, I think it was Stone-on-Trent. And then we went down to Greenham Commons, which was down the southern end. And it was there for about a week. And then they flew us to France. When I got transferred to the 301st Troop Carrier Squadron, which was also in France at that time. When I first got there, they were flying gas up the Patton when he was taking over certain areas. And they say sometimes they go there, the Germans retake the field, and you know, the pilots would land and the Germans would start firing 88s at them. And then somebody noticed, I guess, on my looking at my record, that I was an airplane mechanic. So they said, well, we're going to have some work for you. Well, it wasn't long before that the war was ended. It ended in May. And in July, we were sent to Berlin. We were stationed at Tempelhof Aerodrome. This was a big airport at the time in Germany. And we operated from there. When I got there, I started working on airplanes, became a crew chief, or aerial engineer. But this is like after the war, did a lot of flying around. I was there for, I guess, a good 8 months. And then I had enough points in that they started sending us home. And there we went to Munich. We were there for a couple of weeks, got to go skiing in the Alps. Then we went to Le Havre and got on a Victory ship, come back, got to Kilmer, back to Fort Dix, and then home. But I lived in my sister in Irvington for a year, then I went with another sister after a year for in Union, stayed there for a while, and then I went off on my own, then I got married, and here I am today.